Zambia has played host to the Africa Engineering Week, an event which puts much focus on the role engineers play in the development of the continent. The Engineering Institution of Zambia hosted this year's week-long event alongside the Africa Engineering Conference in Zambia's tourist capital, Livingstone. Housing and Infrastructure Development Minister Vincent Mwale officially launched the Africa Engineering Week on the Zambia National Broadcasting Corporation. This signified the beginning of the week-long events.
We are glad as government and a country to host the regional SDG Center here in Zambia. Countrymen and women, I would like to challenge us Zambians to be prepared for the future. We see future as one which will be technologically advanced. Engineering professionals will be as they have been, the vanguard of our determined march towards a prosperous middle-income country by 2030 without leaving anyone behind. I would like to take this opportunity to encourage more of our young to take up science, mathematics, and engineering at both vocational and university levels as we prepare towards prosperity. I would like to urge the Engineering Institute of Zambia and like-minded institutions to step up activities that will stimulate the interest in engineering profession among our youth and general public. I am therefore glad to note that Engineering Institution of Zambia has been active in carrying out activities aimed at promoting the engineering profession in Zambia. Furthermore, during the coming week, the Engineering Institution of Zambia will be hosting the 4th Africa Engineering Conference and various activities in Livingstone and countrywide with the objective of promoting the engineering profession in the country as well as commemorating the 60th UNESCO Africa Engineering Week.
The Avani Victoria Falls Resort was the venue for the events held from 15th to 21st September 2019. Hundreds of engineers from Nigeria, Egypt, Rwanda, Botswana, Kenya, Zimbabwe, South Africa, Uganda, Namibia, the United Kingdom, Slovenia, and China were all in attendance. Dozens of pupils from various schools in Zambia's southern province had an opportunity to be mentored by engineers who have been in the field for years. This was done on the first day of the Engineering Week, which was dubbed Young Engineers Forum. The Engineering Institution of Zambia, which hosted the events, encouraged the pupils to pursue engineering after school.
Boys and girls, without engineers, would still have been living in society 1.0, hunting and collecting fruits. Equally, without engineers, we won't move our country and our continent to the new society where all Africans can live a decent life. It's for this reason that I encourage all of you pupils to aspire not to be part of the future problems, but to be part of the future solutions for Africa. Join the profession of problem solvers. Be an engineer.
The pupils also got an international perspective on engineering from the United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization.
So today we are in the sustainable development era. This century will later be marked as the time of awakening, where humankind woke up and said, well, this is not the way to go with all these problems that we have. We have to become truly sustainable. And that means we need to address both big imbalances, the inequalities between people and the imbalance between.
The leadership from various engineering bodies also spoke.
We need to innovate the graduate outcomes in engineering. We need to infuse global standards and trends to create the Africa we want for the engineering education and practice. Via relevant CPDs and also quality education systems. Again, we want to attract women and young engineers and young graduates to take up engineering. And when they take up and remain in the pipeline, you have seen the leaks in the pipeline. We would like to motivate those that take engineering to continue and remain and become more creative.
I just thought of just sharing with you, you are probably, most of you are in your period of, in your schooling. And in fact, we normally refer to what we call as the candidacy phase, which happens after your higher education. And that's typically the arena which we refer to you as young professionals. Okay. And so that's just after your higher education phase. But what is important in this process is that some of the fundamentals of your learning happens at your basic education and your higher education stage. And it gives you the adaptability. So if your education system is designed in a way that, for example, if you go into engineering or sciences, that the fundamentals have to be in place at a school level, at a higher education level, and then you start to use these skills and adapt yourselves as you move into the working environment.
From a local touch, the pupils got tips from Tina Piri.
Perhaps one who made the pupils feel like they were in a classroom was Dr. Baldwin Vene.
After all the presentations were made, pupils had an opportunity to pose questions to their mentors.
Do they have emotions? Do they get upset when they're provoked? Or is it a possibility of them to have emotions like 5 years from now? Is it like a possibility of robots having emotions?
So is it possible that they can introduce new skills to improve the company?
They actually talked about mechanical development, such as robotic inventions. So my question is, I'm not really clear, is that not going to replace human beings?
The second day saw the official opening of the Africa Engineering Week. Zambia's President Edgar Lungu was represented at the event by Housing and Infrastructure Minister Vincent Mwale.
A number of countries are reviewing their national development plans, revamping or creating institutions, empowering local authorities and communities, and reaching out to people. This conference is an excellent opportunity to share experiences, best practices, and highlight both achievements and barriers in the engineering profession.
During the event, the issue of the Sustainable Development Goals was top on the agenda for engineers.
It's important to note that the SDGs are not just an additional plan for the world, nor do they replace the specificity and detail of existing international agreements, but they are a shared vision of the world. As engineering professionals, we need mechanisms in place to give a voice to the people, including the poorest and the most vulnerable, so that they can define their needs and ways to address them. Hence, the principle to leave no one behind has many implications for public, social, and technological sector.
Several other speakers also spoke during the official opening of the Africa Engineering Week.
What we must do is to promote ethics and professional conduct. Engineers are people who are right all the time, do the right thing, and are actually standing right before God. And wealth creation is a must, and we must point ourselves to this necessity so that our compatriots, generally their well-being is enhanced. Sustainable engineering is a prerequisite for development. I doubt that there is any engineer here who will think otherwise concerning this. We must be responsible to posterity. And quality of life must not only be enjoyed by a few, but must be enjoyed by all.
We have this Africa Engineering Week, which is our vintage show. This is where Africa comes together. This is where Africa comes together to share ideas with engineers, to showcase through the research that engineers are doing, to offer and proffer solutions to society. So, Honorable Minister, the Africa Engineering Week is a window that we relate with our mother body, the World Federation, our patron UNESCO, and also our young engineers through diversity, inclusivity, and many other policies that we have are put together.
A keynote speaker, Dr. Malin Kanga, could not make it to the event, but she addressed the delegates through a recorded video.
In September 2015, the world came together to declare the 17 Sustainable Development Goals to provide an integrated approach to development which combines considerations of the needs of people, of our planet, for economic growth and prosperity, and most importantly, for peace and justice in our institutions. Every one of these goals requires engineering. Therefore, the advancement of the Sustainable Development Goals is a key strategic objective of the World Federation of Engineering Organizations.
In the afternoon, engineers were taken on a tour of the Kazungula Bridge, a massive engineering project being undertaken by Zambia and Botswana across the Zambezi River. Here, the engineers got first-hand information on how some of their colleagues are implementing this project, which has far-reaching repercussions on the environment.
We've got noise monitors. We monitor the sounds which are actually being generated on the bridge so that the wildlife is not actually affected. And we also test the waters that there is no pollution from what we are doing here. So for example, the fishes which were here before the construction, we fish again and see whether the community has actually been depleted or not. I'm glad to report to you that there are strict environmental controls. We've got an active environmental control officer who's actually looking at the issues. Apart from the engineering side, I'm also responsible for safety, and we proudly like to report to you that we've achieved over 7 million hours where there's no lost time injury. We've actually gone to the next target, is 8 million hours, where we want people not to be disabled as a result of working on the bridge. That's why we gave you PPE and the basic safety induction.
The engineers walked along the bridge from the Zambian side to the Botswana side. It is here where they learned that while standing in the middle of the bridge, they could see Zambia, Namibia, Botswana, and Zimbabwe from one point. After an hour of touring, the Engineering Institution of Zambia appreciated the tour.
For us, Botswana and Zambia, this is a masterpiece. This is a project that we are proud of. and we had to make all efforts to bring our visitors here. And it is a project that is being built 50-50 contribution between the two countries. So for what we've experienced this afternoon, I just wish to thank the project team led by Engineer Nyerenda for their time. If you look at your watches now, they should have knocked off, but I know for them to have built this, they are used to overtime and putting in those hours.
On the third day of the Africa Engineering Week, delegates were split into groups to discuss various topical issues. At the Protea Hotel, engineers got capacity building on the regulation of engineering professions across the continent. A panel of distinguished engineers from across Africa took turns in making presentations.
The engineering community includes professional engineering institutions. It includes professional engineering affiliates. It includes the regulators. So all these together would come to be known as the professional engineering community. But then the body that looks after the professional engineering institutions is the professional engineering organization, which actually is what the Federation of African Engineering Organizations is interested in. So it is something that we should really take an interest in at this level of FAO.
And we are lucky in Africa that South Africa meets the art, and they are ready to share. And the Engineering Alliance is going into contract soon with FAO, so that they can be bringing in assessors to train trainers who will go and do accreditations to the level that is required by the Alliance, to our universities. And these assessors must involve academia and industry. And like governments, we will need the blessing of our governments in terms of the right policy framework.
If there's a concoction of programs that do not add to the same, it must be the same. An engineer must be able to solve problems. We just spoke about the problem with the water and sanitation at the moment. Many of them cut off the programs, but they are unable to solve those problems or to align to that. And that is also seen when you go to industry. The employers are complaining that you produce these people, but there's nothing that they can do.
Engineers who had burning questions also had a chance to air out their views.
Now, I'm just thinking of the technicalities of repealing an act. How would that be undertaken if the engineers are regulating themselves and not reporting to a government agency or an institution? How do you get to repeal an act, especially that the engineering body is not represented in parliament? So how would be the best practice for that?
Do you have a clear strategy of how you help countries? We get so many loans to do engineering projects. Most of it because of engineering, because of political interference. We rarely see the benefits. But when it's felt, I think the engineer is the one to take the blame. So how do you hope to protect the engineering professionals vis-a-vis political interference?
Is there any plan by IEA, International Engineering Alliance, to come up with something like certification like that, that will promote or catapult the opportunities for young engineers in practice, both in private and government sectors?
On the fourth day, presentations continued at the Protea Hotel in the morning. A number of presentations were made.
Now, just in terms of policy, now, when we have to address policymakers at a very high level, we need to understand one aspect, is that every nation will do what it believes is in its best interest for their context. So to dictate exactly how to build capacity for a particular nation is the nation's prerogative, because they need to position themselves. So it is also very important that we also start to position the way we do capacity building towards the nation's strategy, okay? And nations need to determine that. However, there are some generic ways in how to do that. Now, the approach before in terms of building capacity, especially when it comes to education, educational institutions, was around this concept called centers of excellence. I'm sure you would have heard around that. So it was the hub and spoke model. As we start to transform into this new world, there is a new concept I want to introduce. It's called networks of specialization. It means that you can start to network in a specific sphere within your country and beyond, within a network, and that's how you build network capability. Because the days of building hubs and infrastructure that is just focused is starting to be disintegrated.
In the afternoon, deliberations shifted to the Avani Victoria Falls Resort. Here, Zambia's power utility company ZESCO made a presentation on the role engineers are playing in providing power supply to the nation.
And I'm proud to mention that currently the optic fiber network covers the entire country and including the sub-region. The second innovation we had to derive was with complaints management. We devised the centralized national call center where clients were able to lodge in complaints from whichever location. So you, as opposed to the old system, there was no need for you to walk into ZESCO customer service center for you to report your faults. All you need to do now is either from the comfort of your home or your office, if you've got a fault, you are able to report just by using your mobile phone.
On the final day of the Africa Engineering Week, women engineers took center stage. This was during their second Women in Engineering Forum held at the Avani Victoria Falls Resort. The Zambian section of the Women in Engineering explained the history of the section.
Efforts to form a platform to serve as a voice for women in engineering in Zambia date back to 2011. In 2015, the 58th Council of the Engineering Institution of Zambia approved formation of the Zambia Women in Engineering section, which was officially launched on 30th January 2016. To date, three executives have been in place. An interim executive, which was led by Lieutenant Colonel Engineer Lillian Mwina, from January 2016 to April 2017. Unfortunately, she's not with us because of other commitments. This was followed by the first elected executive, which came into office in April 2017 until April 2019. And this was led by our rather young engineer Toperewa Namwinga Kawe. And so the current executive, which was ushered in office in April 2019, is the third, and I chair it. As you will notice, the section is still in its infancy and is eager to learn from others. So hosting this conference, therefore, offers a rare opportunity to learn and share experience, but also to network. The vision of the Zambian Women in Engineering section is to build EIZ into a world-class gender-based engineering fraternity in which men and women have equal opportunity for career advancement, well-being, and professional development in Zambia. The core purpose of the mission of the section is to increase the number and advance the prominence of women in engineering in Zambia. It is also to ensure national competitiveness by leading and supporting Engineering Institution of Zambia's efforts to expand women participation and improve the quality of life for women in engineering professionals.
During the event, the Engineering Institution of Zambia bemoaned the stereotypes against girls which hinder them from engaging in challenging jobs.
Engineering is dominated by men. We need to break the barriers. The journey begins today. Let's put our heads together in this conference and generate ideas that will lead our women to prosperity, and indeed prosperity that is fully inclusive. There are stereotypes in the present day that are embedded in African culture, stereotypes that impede the development of the girl child. Some of these stereotypes, they undermine the girl child to a very bad extent. The girl child is in many African cultures seen as a potential wife, as opposed to a potential leader. Leadership in engineering is not a preserve for men. Women are equally born to lead. Our theme today tells us to stop the talking, stop listening to fairy tale stories. We need to act today. Women should ask themselves, what are we as women doing that promotes the continuation of this stereotype? How are we as women enemies of our own progress? What are we doing that perpetuates these stereotypes? This conference today should interrogate these things and look for solutions.
Various speakers had an opportunity to address the women engineers who came from across Africa.
The committee, in recognition of the need to have women come together as one to chart a course for effective practice of engineering, get ourselves involved in engineering leadership, and just like the Vice President EIZ has said, that we need to take it, and said, no more talking, take action. And I asked the President of FAO, who takes the action, the men or the women? So I think it's a food for thought. The women have been taking action. I think the men should do the needful now and make sure that the women get into leadership position. And because we also want to be key players in driving the sustainable development goal across the continent, we thought it necessary to have this forum. And I really want to appreciate the leadership of the FAO, who gladly accepted this decision. And last year at the communique session, we all agreed that this forum has become a permanent feature in the African Engineering Week. And so that's why we're having this second one. Please, can we give FAO a big round of applause?
Why the career of women is so hard? Because some is social culture in China. Okay, you women, you should be just provide service for men, okay? That is from when I was born. Yeah, the man is high, women is lower. But now it's much better. Family education, the expectation of parents. The parents always want girls to have a good wife, okay? A good husband, sorry about that. And a family, right? But for men, the son, okay, you need to have the career successful because you need to support the family. The different family expectations.
Various women engineers were given awards during the event to appreciate the role they have played on the continent.
That she's indeed a role model in the engineering profession in the continent, and we all still look up to her to show us the way. Thank you very much.
Zambia and Kenya were among the recipients for hosting engineering events. Akoswa Buadu mentored the female pupils who were in the room. She spoke to them on how they can make a difference by challenging the narrative that sciences are for men.
We believe that mentorship provides the mentee with someone to inspire you. It provides visible role models. Knowing that someone has done it gives you validation of your dreams. You know your dreams are valid because you can see that Akosia has done it. It gives you an opportunity to learn from someone else's mistakes. So we as women don't always have to make the same mistakes all the time. We believe that a good and a healthy mentoring relationship allows you to bounce off your ideas of someone who has been there before and balance off your ideas of them.
At the end of the Women in Engineering Forum, a set of resolutions was agreed at. The icing on the cake for the forum came when a veteran female engineer, Diane Muya, was conferred with the title of the Fellow of the Engineering Institution of Zambia.
Did score, did very well, went to the university, got a scholarship in my third year, then got another scholarship to do my first master's. First worked for Zamtel, it's a Zambia telecommunications company. And then moved to Standard Chartered Bank. And one of the things that struck me when I was in the bank is the only time I was in the boardroom was under the table making sure there's connectivity in the room. And I felt, as an engineer, I could make better decisions than the ones that were being made on the table. So I challenged my boss and said, I want to try something different. Can you trust me with something else? And this boss, bless his heart, was a man. So men, we need you to give us that opportunity to prove that we're not just good under the table. So the job in Zanaco, I was headhunted to be a chief operations officer. And when they headhunt you, it means you're doing whatever you're doing very well. Thank you. I look after information technology. I look after the change management office. I look after premises and facilities, branch and channel support, payment center, and also operations risk. Zanaco has more than 70 branches and agencies and more than 200 ATMs. So it's a very big operation.
Engineer Muya joins a few female engineers who have this prestigious title. Perhaps one of the highlights of the Africa Engineering Week was the awarding of various engineers and prominent Africans. Rwandan President Paul Kagame, who has transformed his country from a war-torn and genocide-plagued country to an African success story, was awarded by the Federation of African Engineering Organizations. Egyptian President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi was another recipient. Throughout the duration of the Engineering Week, various companies and stakeholders in the engineering field set up booths at the venue. Here, delegates learned more about what these firms do in their respective countries. After 5 days of intense capacity building, the Africa Engineering Week was officially closed by Transport and Communication Permanent Secretary, Engineer Meshack Lungu. Engineers closed the Engineering Week with a gala dinner at the Avani Victoria Falls Resort with music provided by the Sakala Brothers.